thank you for joining us tonight for our first official 2018 Teen Takeover service. If you didn't notice, most of the people up here are under the age of 18. But they're going to take over the service tonight. So I want to welcome Mr. Justin Myers to begin our service with a song.
Please stand as we sing at Calvary 187, at Calvary 187.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing that it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free.
Okay, once you guys find your seat, we're gonna continue singing at Calvary 187.
Preacher tonight is Mr. Donovan Schmidt. He's going to bring a message out of the book of Proverbs. Would you give him your full attention as he comes to preach at this time?
Would you all please take your Bibles and turn to Proverbs 22:1. That verse says, a good name is rather to be chosen than great riches and loving favor rather than silver and gold. My first point is your name is important. What is a good name? A good name is a testimony, a family name. Your name always means something to someone. Nike is the LeBron James, Under Armour, and Stephen Curry, Adidas failed. Great Riches. Explanation. What is Great Riches? Money. Satan entices you with a price tag. How much money do you think it would take to make a 5-year-old do something dumb? $5, $10. An adult, it would take much more money than that. And then we have your relationship with others is important. Loving favor. The need for building love and relationships. My grandpa was very good at drywall, and if he was your friend, he would always give you a deal. But if you did not know him, then he would not give you a good deal. My next point is silver and gold. Silver and gold just means having all the best things, like the best shoes, the newest phone, stuff like that. A loyal carpenter named John was working for a very successful building contractor who called him up one day and said, "John, I'm putting you in charge of the next house we built. I want you to order all the materials and oversee the whole job from the ground up." John accepted the assignment with great enthusiasm and excitement. For 10 days before the ground was broken up at the building site, John studied the blueprints. He checked every measurement and specification. Suddenly, he had a thought. If I really am in charge, why couldn't I just cut a few corners, use less expensive materials, and put all the extra money in my pocket? Who would know the difference? Once the house is painted, it will look great. John said about his scheme and ordered second grade lumber, but on his reports indicated that it was top grade. Ordered inexpensive concrete for the foundation, put in cheap wiring, cut every corner he could. Yet he reported the purchase of much better materials. When the home was complete and fully painted, he invited the contractor to come and see it. John said to the contractor, What a magnificent job you have done. You have been such a good and faithful carpenter over all these years. I have decided to show my gratitude by giving you this house as a gift." If John just would have done what he was supposed to, this would have never happened, and he would have not had to put more money into his house. Will you have a good name? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day, Lord. I pray help us to have a good name, to choose it over money, or have the best things, Lord. And I pray help the rest of the service go well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our name is important. Our next preacher is Mr. Justin Myers. He is 13 years old in the 7th grade, and I hope you give him your full attention as he preaches out of the book of Ephesians tonight.
Please open your Bibles up to Ephesians 4:29. And that says, "Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to use of edifying, that may minister grace unto the hearers." My first command is to don't use corrupt words. And corrupt words mean empty, fake, or bad words. We should never use words that are hurtful or words that will bring people down. I remember once my grandmother told me that, because she's a nurse, and she told me that there was a person that was working there, and she had a disability. And because of her disability, she couldn't do a lot of the other things that the other nurses could do. And my grandma told me that a lot of people would make fun of her or say things about her behind her back because of the disability she had. And she didn't like that, and she tried to stick up for herself, but people would just say more and more things that were hurtful to her. and then a few months later she committed suicide. And that's because of the words that people use. The words that we should use words that are edifying to one another, words that lift others up, and not the words that bring people down. My second command is to use words that are edifying. Edifying means to build up, to lift people up. I watch this show, and on their birthdays, they have 19 kids on their birthdays, they share praises. And what that is they say things about the person that is their birthday, about what they think they did good on that year. So one thing that they say is very encouraging, you lift others up, and that's what edifying means. And before, because you will always remember the bad things, but you always still remember the good things too. My third command is, why use words that are edifying? We should always use words that are edifying because it says in God's word that it may minister grace unto the hearers. So, which means that passage says, this means that we should be nice to people, or we should say loving things to people that are not nice to us. So our enemies, people that we don't like, we should share grace to them too, even though sometimes they don't. But we should do it. We should do it out of respect for God. And I remember when I was in first grade, and one of my friends, we had a karaoke party. In our class, and I was singing, and one of my friends, well, he wasn't my friend then, but he said, you can't sing. And I was like, I can't? And so he's like, you can't sing. And every single time I would sing or anything, because I walk around singing a lot, but when I used to see that, he was like, you can't sing. So every single time I used to sing or something, I used to try so hard to sing well, when it was just his perspective of me not singing good. So that's why we should always use words that are edifying, even though, yeah, sometimes it really can be hard. Some people can really be aggravating. Some people can get on your nerves, but we should always try and strive to use good words. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for today. Thank you for allowing us to be able to be here today. Lord, I pray that all of us, we can get this message and use words that are edifying to each other. Lord, I pray that the rest of the service goes well. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please stand as we sing, Are You Washed by the Blood? 330, Are You Washed by the Blood?
Jacob Swartz. He is one of our male team leaders in the youth group, and I appreciate his leadership. And I ask that you pay attention as he brings the word tonight.
You have your Bibles. Please turn them to Daniel chapter 3, and we'll be looking at verse 26. While you're turning there, tonight we will be talking about the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So if I were to ask each of you in this room tonight, do you have faith in God? The vast majority would say yes. Well, guess what? The devil and his demons have faith in God too. But God doesn't honor their faith. These men had faith that God honors. Do you have faith that God honors? Not in general, but in specific areas of your life. Let's read in Daniel 3 and verse 26. It says, "Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth of the midst of the fire." So I'm going to show you three walls that you need to jump in order to have faith that God honors. The first wall is you need to have faith in spite of commandments. In verse 4 through 6 says, "Then a herald cried aloud, to you it is a command, O people, nations, and languages, that at what time do you hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up. So as we see, Nebuchadnezzar's command was that you had to bow down to his statue when you hear the instruments being played. This goes against what God's word says. God's word should be superior over the government, over any school, the law, the White House, or anyone or anything that goes against God's word. Just like Daniel. When Daniel was in the land, he was in the land, and King Darius was king, it was illegal to pray to God, but Daniel still did it anyway. Daniel had faith that God would take care of him. When they threw Daniel in the lion's den, Daniel had faith that God would keep him safe. So the second wall is you need to have faith in spite of circumstances. Verse 11 says, "And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth, that he should be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace." You need to have faith during persecution, impending death, an angry ruler, when there is no justice system, or an impossible command to follow. So, what is stopping you from having faith? Joseph had faith even though he was thrown in prison. If he could have faith when he was thrown in prison, we should be able to have faith in any circumstance or trial we go through in our life. And lastly, you need to have faith in spite of consequences. Verse 21 says, "Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fire furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and..." Wrong verse. 21. "Then these men were bound in their coats, their hosen, and their hats, and their other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace." You need to have faith in God in spite of trying to be burned by fire like these men were, being remembered as fools, or being embarrassed for being a Christian. So, in conclusion, do you have faith that God honors? Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day, Lord. Just please help the teens, just calm their nerves, and just please help everyone to have faith that God honors, and just please help the rest of the night to go well. In Jesus' name, amen.
We've had three messages so far, and want to take a moment tonight and ask the ushers if they would come forward to prepare to receive this evening's offering. I was asking teens to volunteer for different things to do, and all the girls wanted to preach and do the song leading. And then we weren't sure if a couple people were going to show up. And then tonight, the guys, I'll do this. And then the people ended up showing up. So praise the Lord for that. Ushers, if you want to go ahead and come to the front, and we will pray for this evening's offering. Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. Thank you for showing us that these teenagers are growing in their faith. pray that you bless tonight's offering, help to further the ministry here at Liberty Baptist Church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Student preacher tonight is Mr. Devin Pruitt. He's our other team leader in the youth department and does a great job getting the teens rallied up, and invite you to pay close attention as he brings a message tonight. All the others prepared their messages for a competition, and that's great. He specifically prepared this for tonight. So he thought through it. This is something that he believes is a great need in our day. Devin, would you come preach?
Have you guys liked the preaching tonight?
Yeah.
It's refreshing to hear something short and sweet. Boy, do I have a gift for you. Like Pastor George said, I bring a message tonight that something passionate to me, something that I've noticed in our society, something that I think needs to be said. We can agree to disagree, but I just felt the Holy Spirit leading me to say this, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Let's pray first. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you that we could have this teen takeover service. Thank you that for all the preachers and all the singers and everyone doing what they can to the best of their ability. Just help me tonight as I preach. Just help me that I can speak to someone's heart, Lord. Even one person would be great, Lord. And I just thank you for everything that you've given us, for all that we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. As we look around in American society, or from what we hear on the news or anywhere where you hear stuff, there's tons of problems, ranging from drugs and Bradenton, there's a huge opioid crisis, or to problems like radicalism. But there's one problem that I think is one of the most dangerous of all, and that's the regression of our youth. So for my message today, I want to bring up three things we can do to protect our youth. And if you will, please turn with me to Proverbs 22:6. Our greatest natural resource is the youth. For a society to be able to thrive and survive, one thing must happen. The younger generation, the kids, must know how to act, and they must be brought up right. In Proverbs 22:6, it says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." Future parents, parents with young kids, make sure you teach your children the biblical values they need to know. Make sure you instill them with the right values that will keep them out of trouble and will help them when they are older. And the Bible says if you do this, they will not depart from it. We can find these values in Galatians 5:22-23. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance." Wouldn't that be great if every parent in America taught their kids that? We can teach the kids these things by reading the Bible with them and by making sure they actually understand the Bible. You know, it's one thing to read the Bible as a kid, but it's a whole other thing to understand it as a kid. I know one thing that's helped me understand the Bible more is when Pastor George preaches in Sunday school or youth group, he instead of just preaching and us just hearing his message, he asked us questions. You know, he asked us, what does that mean? Or, you know, what do we think about this? And it really helps us as teens to, you know, apply it to ourselves and to understand what we're actually hearing. And I know one thing that's been making me concerned recently, most of you probably know about the Parkland shooting that's happened. And there's many, many different takes on it, many different people coming out of it. One person I'm sure you all know is David Hogg. It seems every time he gets on TV and has an interview, he says something, you know, more horrendous or vile, or, you know, whoever it's about. And I feel awful for what this kid had to go through, and I know he has every right to speak. But if you listen into what he has to say, some of the stuff he's saying is incredible. Recently, he had an interview, and someone asked him, you know, why is he so adamant about pushing for gun control? You know, why is he doing what he's doing? And this is what he said. Sadly, that's what we have to do with our government. Our parents don't know how to use a expletive democracy, so we have to. This is coming from a 17 or 18-year-old kid, someone who's my age. I could go on and on about him, but he's also likened people like Marco Rubio and the NRA to child murderers with blood on their hands. If he were to be taught biblical values, I think we can all agree that he wouldn't be saying things like this. And I wish I could say it was just him or a few people that are doing these, but the reality is that we have a whole generation of college kids who don't even see people that they disagree with as good people. For those of you that don't know me, I'm very interested in politics and news, and you know, I love all that stuff. And there's a whole, you know, every college, you know, you hear, there's kids who think, you know, killing a baby is okay, or gay marriage is healthy and a benefit to society. And if you disagree with them in any way, even if it's respectful, they'll throw whatever they can at you. They'll call you a racist, a bigot, you know, anything they can to degrade you and just put you into the ground. And this isn't to say that it's entirely the, you know, the parents of these children's fault, but if we were to teach them these biblical values that we can find in the Bible, this would not be nearly as much of a problem. Another way to protect the next generation is to protect the institution of marriage. If you can, turn with me to Ephesians 5, 25 through 33. Here it reads, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife, even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband." Here, we can see the blueprint for marriage. Men need to love their wives and make sure they are actually ready to leave his father and mother and be joined with his wife. And women need to reverence their husbands or have deep respect for him, just as it says in the passage. Let me give you a few statistics about marriage and families. Nearly 2 out of every 5 children live without their fathers. Children from fatherless homes are 5 times more likely to commit suicide, 24 more times more likely to run away from home, 12 times more likely to commit rape, and 7 times more likely to be pregnant as a teenager. The marriage rate has declined 50% since 1970, and this has even been a problem in Christian society, in which around 50% of 2 Christians getting married end in divorce. We need to teach kids that marriage is not something to be taken lightly, and that it's something that is extremely important. This could be solved by just teaching them what the Bible says about marriage. Men need to love their wives, and when it says love, it means more than just a feeling. Many teens these days date just to date because they have a feeling, but many of them have it very wrong. Dating is meant to be a step towards marriage. You date someone to see if you want to spend the rest of your life with them. It's amazing how many problems can be solved by just reading the Bible. We have a younger generation of people who think marriage is a hindrance, and that they can have sex with anyone whenever they want. If we can teach the next generations that marriage is a full-time commitment and not a part-time job, we could bring back what it really means to get married. Amen. And lastly, The third way to protect the next generation is to not let our standards limit the Holy Spirit. If you can, turn with me to Psalms 127. Starting in verse 3, it says, "Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. As arrows are in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. Happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with the enemies of the gate." So in this verse, or these verses, we can see that children are a heritage of the Lord. They are a gift from him. Children are temporarily under a parent's care until they come of age that they can leave the house and live on their own. This means, however, that children need to be raised from a state of complete dependence to a state of complete independence so that we can release them to God when they are ready. In Deuteronomy 6, we can see an essential program for the development of children. Starting in verse 5, it says, "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by thy way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house, and on thy gates." And if you jump down to verse 20, it says, "And when thy son asketh thee in time to come, saying, What mean the testimonies, and the statutes, and the judgments, which the Lord our God hath commanded you? Then thou shalt say unto thy son, We were Pharaoh's bondmen in Egypt, and the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand, and the Lord showed signs and wonders, great and sore, upon Egypt, upon Pharaoh, and upon all of his household, before our eyes. And he brought us out from thence, that he might bring us in to give us in the land which he sware unto our fathers." We need to teach children biblical principles, because if we do not, children will not grow up as they're supposed to. If we try to raise children by how natural it feels to us, we will fail. We as humans have an inherent sin nature, and what comes naturally to us may not be necessarily good. That is why if we teach children the Bible and raise them up as the Bible says to, and not how we feel we should, then it shall be our righteousness, as it says in verse 25. I know in my own life, my mom made the decision to take me out of a Christian school. To some, that may seem like a wrong choice to do. You know, why would you take your kid out of a Christian school, especially one that is in your own church? But as a result of me leaving the school, I was able to get much of my friend group saved. In fact, the majority of my friend group saved. I would have never been able to do that had I never left the Christian school and had gone to a public middle and high school. Another example is, what if you're invited out to dinner by an unsaved friend or family member? When you get to the restaurant, there's music there that's playing and it isn't good, or maybe you disagree with it. That is your standard. You don't like to listen to that music, you think it's bad. But what if the Holy Spirit is leading you into that restaurant? Because maybe that unsaved family member or friend can get saved if you witness to them. Would you not have dinner with them just because you disagree with the music, even if they may get saved? Now, I'm not sitting up here saying that taking your kid out of a Christian school or a Christian environment, or even putting yourself in a bad environment is always the right choice. But you shouldn't close off decisions for your kids if the Holy Spirit could use that situation. I know it was a hard decision for my mom to put me into an environment that wasn't exactly Christian, but I was able to grow from it. I was able to see things that were wrong with my generation and realize how bad it is. I've seen what drugs and drinking can do to teens and have realized it isn't cool to ruin your body. However, I think missionary John Falconer said it best. I have but one candle of life to burn, and I'd rather burn it out in a land filled with darkness than in a land filled with light. I truly believe if we can do all these things, we can have more hope for a better future for ourselves and our kids. I say all of this to leave you with this passage found in Proverbs 30, verses 11 through 14. There is a generation that curses their father and doth not bless their mother. There is a generation that are pure in their own eyes and yet is not washed from their filthiness. There is a generation, oh how lofty are their eyes, and their eyelids are lifted up. There is a generation whose teeth are as swords and their jaw teeth as knives, to devour the poor from off the earth and the needy from among men. I don't know if those verses have ever rung more true, but I hope that we can fix our generation and the ones after it.
Bibles, go ahead and turn to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. Pastor's going to read his Bible no matter what time he wakes up. And aren't you glad we have a pastor that does that? You know, a pastor that when he makes a flight, you know, he's getting up even earlier than when that flight is to read his Bible, to pray, to study. And he cares about you. And he loves you. Galatians chapter 6. I want to thank Pastor publicly for allowing the teens to take the service tonight. I hope you all enjoyed hearing from their hearts and seeing them use their gifts and talents to serve the Lord. Thank you for the work of the school in helping them develop their talents. A lot of the songs that you heard tonight were practiced for many, many hours, and the messages were worked on as well. So thank you for all you teachers that labor day in and day out. Galatians chapter 6, and verse number 7 says, "Be not deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not." Now, there's three principles. I'm not a farmer, but there's three principles about sowing and reaping that I'd like to bring to your attention tonight. First of all, you reap after you sow. You reap after you sow. You won't have tomatoes before you plant the seeds. You're not going to see a tree grow until you plant it. You're not going to see things come into your life before you plant the seeds to start them. You're not going to see your prayers answered until you pray. You're not going to see God help you through temptation until you're reading your Bible and learning it and memorizing it to the point where you have a verse that comes to mind when you're tempted with a certain sin that you struggle with. You're not going to see that fruit until after you sow. You reap after you sow. You know, I think of the message about Daniel and the three friends in the fiery furnace. You know, that fiery furnace didn't grow their faith. Their faith was revealed through that fiery furnace. When we go through storms in our life, those storms don't give us that faith. Those storms simply reveal what's already there. If you don't have faith before the storm, you're not going to have faith in the storm. You sow, you reap after you sow. Secondly, you reap what you sow. If you plant apples, you're not going to get an orange tree. If you plant, you know, a watermelon, you're not going to get a watermelon tree either. Okay? Some of you guys will get that after. You reap what you sow. Verse number 8, "For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting." When you sow kind words, as Justin said, you're going to reap kind words back to you. When you minister grace to the hearers, when you sow mean words, you may not feel the mean words, but they're going to be said about you behind your back, probably to somebody else, that you hurt them. You're going to reap what you sow. When you sow a good testimony, as Donovan preached about, if you share the gospel, you will see people saved. If you have a good testimony, you're going to have a good name, to where his grandpa will give you a good deal. You're going to reap what you sow. You reap after you sow, you reap what you sow, and finally, you reap more than you sow. You reap more than you sow, and it's a good thing and it's a bad thing. When you sow to your flesh, you reap more than what you sow. You reap corruption. When you sow to the Spirit, you reap life everlasting. You benefit greater. You know, I don't know how many of you in here are farmers, but when you seed hoping for a harvest. And you can't sow too much seed where you're not going to have a harvest. God is going to bring that harvest. He said he will build his church. When you sow, you reap more than you sow. When you sow selfishness in your home, your spouse will be selfish. Your kids will be selfish. Your dog may even be selfish. You're so selfish. You reap more than you sow. What are you sowing tonight? Do you have a good name? Are you using kind words? Or are you using corrupt words? Is your faith a faith that God honors? Are you investing in this next generation? What you invest in this generation will reap for years to come. Think about yourself. When you got saved, the fruit that you've borne not only amounts to your account, but whoever led you to Christ. You can trace that all the way back. It's a constant multiplication of growth. You're going to reap more than you sow. So would you decide tonight, you're going to sow good seed. You're going to invest in the next generation of kids. You're not going to just go home after work and chill on the couch and let your kids raise themselves. You're not just going to give up on these kids. Most of you, a lot of you deal with younger kids every single day, and man, every day is a battle, and you're struggling, and you're fighting, and if you're at that point where you can't take it anymore, God will bring the harvest. God will cause a reaping. God will bring that to pass. You've sown that seed, and that water is our prayer. We can't do it. You know, sometimes I think of some of you guys, and I'm not going to say who, but there's some things that you guys do that just get on my nerves, and I'm not going to tell you what. You probably already know. And I just think, you know, man, when is that kid going to get it? When? I can't do it. I've got to pray. I've got to give it to God, and when we pray, God can do a work. If we were just left to ourselves, we're all going to gradually go down a downward spiral. If we're left to ourselves, that's just the nature of man. But when we pray, when we invest our time in prayer, when we invest our time in the next generation, we can see God do a work. And if you didn't get anything else tonight, don't give up on this generation. We've got some good kids here. And we will see a harvest one day that will abound to your account. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the gift of eternal life. We thank you for your word and for what we can learn from it. I pray that tonight you'd work on each of our hearts. I know you've worked on mine. I pray that each person tonight would leave here better than they came. In Jesus' name, amen. And with your head still bowed, if you say, God worked in my heart tonight, I challenge you, in just a moment as we stand, would you come forward and seal that with a decision at the altar or in your seat? Would you make that decision? I'm not going to give up. I'm going to keep investing. I'm going to keep sowing. I'm going to keep going forward. Would you stand with me as the piano begins to play the song of invitation? Just as I am. If God spoke to your heart, would you take care of that in your pew or at the altar tonight?
Your Lamb of God, I appreciated that service tonight. Amen. I think the young people did a great job. Hey, Brother Zaris, you're about an hour late.
Some people don't ever change.
We're glad to see you, man. Why don't you come up here and just say howdy to us? George Zaris, Christian Radio International, our missionary to Christian Radio International. We're glad to have him. Give him a big hand. Amen. We're glad to have him.
You know what? I've got a bad cold, brother, and I don't want you to get it.
Oh, well, here we go.
Say a word to it, would you?
If there's one guy I thought would never change, it was Gary Jackson. We walked in. They said, you know, church started an hour ago? We said, what? Well, praise the Lord. It's exciting to be here. What God is doing around the world is just awesome. I tell you, he's not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. And our Iranian preacher snuck back into the country, unbeknownst to me, and he went over to Dallas-Fort Worth area, and he preached on internet TV for an hour, and the phones lit up so much that Brother Hormuz Shariat, who runs the Iran Alive ministry, called me and said, Brother Zaris, we can't have him on just two or three times a week. We need him on every day. And so I said, okay, brother, what's it going to cost? Because that's always what I've got to take care of and figure out how to pay for. And so he told me. So Michael was in the country, Michael Garmy, some of you remember him. And we just took him all around the Midwest for 10 weeks. And people were excited as all get out. But while we were going, Brother Gary, you know how God does things. God says, okay, you're going to be faithful in that, then here's something else. So he gave us the opportunity to put Michael on internet radio, on satellite radio, and then, since he was going on radio, we said, well, we'll put you on our radio station in Basra, Iraq, southern Iraq, in the Ur of the Chaldees area, because that station, radio station signals don't care anything about country boundaries. And we broadcast to 1 million people in Iran. And so Michael will be broadcasting on all of those outlets. So satellite TV, satellite radio, internet radio, and regular radio. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Yes, praise the Lord. Probably to an audience on all of those of at least 10 million people every time he opens his mouth. I mean, it's just mind-boggling. But I keep telling you, God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And then you'll be happy to know that we just sent a check 2 weeks ago to Iraq for $75,000 to put on the third radio station in Mosul, Iraq, which is ancient Nineveh. The tower is up.